Assalamu alaikum rahmatullah, peace be on you. Some of you may have heard of Mohammed Hijab. He's an individual who likes to make YouTube videos debating non-Muslims and indeed Muslims of other denominations. He's well known for his, shall we put it nicely, passionate style, his ability to jump unsuspecting people on the street, and his skill at editing out compromising parts of his debates online. In fact, one Ahmadi Muslim under the platform Ahmadi Answers has already answered Mr. Hijab twice, but it seems Mr. Hijab can't get enough. So he's back with a video titled Disproving Ahmadiyya with one argument, where he attempts to critique the prophecy of the promised Messiah. But before we get into it, I want to ask Mr. Hijab a serious question. Mr. Hijab, you're so eager to tell us who the false prophets are, but why don't you show us who the true prophets are? The Quran tells us that God never punishes a people until he sends a messenger. So where is the messenger sent to you? Because when I look in the world, I see Muslims sadly being punished everywhere. Muslims are bombed by Christian nations in the West and bombed by Jews in Israel. We are butchered in Kashmir by Hindus and massacred by Buddhists in Myanmar. Even atheists in China are humiliating and torturing Muslims among the Uyghurs. So how about you stop telling us who the false prophets are and tell us instead who is the true prophet sent to you, whom you've rejected, to deserve this punishment at the hands of the whole world? Now let's get into it. Mr. Hijab's main argument focuses on a statement of the founder of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community, His Holiness Mirza Ghulam Ahmad, whom Ahmadi Muslims believe was the promised Messiah and Imam Mahdi, prophesied by the Prophet of Islam, on whom be peace, to come in the latter days to revive the beautiful and peaceful teachings of Islam and propagate it to the world. That statement is as follows, quote, "Let it be known to the unbelieving person that my truthfulness or falsehood will be judged on my prophecies. There is no better touchstone for it." This is, as Mr. Hijab notes, a very fair test. After all, if God knows the future and the role of a prophet is to prophesy, what better way to test his claim than to look at his prophecies? But that's where Mr. Hijab goes wrong. He doesn't look at the prophecies of the promised Messiah. Instead, he goes on to tell half a story and with it a half-baked conclusion. He narrates an incident in the life of the promised Messiah, on whom be peace, relating to some of his distant relatives. One of the promised Messiah's relatives was called Mirza Ahmad Beg. His family became deeply irreligious. The promised Messiah wrote about them, quote, "They advanced daily in their error and arrogance till they decided to propagate their evil thoughts and mislead the ignorant ones with their delusions. They published a document in which they abused the Holy Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, reviled the word of God, and denied the existence of God, hallowed be his name." This document was given wide publicity in the Christian press. It caused the promised Messiah immense grief to hear abuse against his beloved Prophet Muhammad, peace be on him, coming from a relative of his. These are the people Mr. Hijab is speaking in favour of, individuals who wrote tracts arguing against God's existence, against the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, and against the religion of Islam. The promised Messiah continues in his book, quote, "I found it full of such abusive language that could rend the bosom of heaven asunder. Thereupon I bolted my doors and supplicated my Lord the Bountiful, prostrating before him and saying, My Lord, help thy servant and humiliate thy enemies. Respond to me, O Lord, respond to me. How long will they mock thee and thy messenger? How long will they call thy book false and abuse thy messenger? I beseech thee of thine mercy, O ever-living, self-subsisting helper." It should be noted that the promised Messiah's concern was not of a personal nature. He had no personal motive against them. The tract published by the Beg family was in relation to the existence of God and the truth of Islam. The matter was a theological dispute, not a personal one. In response to his humble supplications, God revealed to the promised Messiah the following, quote, "I have observed their misconduct and wickedness, and I shall soon destroy them under heaven through different types of calamities, and you will soon see how I shall deal with them. I have the power to do all that I will. I shall make their women widows and their children orphans, and shall ruin their homes so that they might be punished for their misdeeds. I shall not destroy them at one stroke, but gradually, so that they may turn back and repent." Unfortunately for their family, they did not repent at first. God had warned that they would be destroyed slowly, so that they might have time to repent. And so calamity after calamity began to befall the family. First, Mirza Ahmad Beg's niece, a young woman of 25, died, leaving behind an infant child and a widowed husband. Then her father, Mirza Ahmad Beg's own brother, Nizamuddin Beg, also died. Witnessing this quick succession of deaths, some in the next generation took heed. The other two children of Nizamuddin Beg became followers of the promised Messiah. Their cousin too, another niece of Mirza Ahmad Beg by name Khurshid Begum, accepted the promised Messiah also. Subsequently, Mirza Ahmad Beg was, due to a legal case, forced to turn to the promised Messiah for help with it. The promised Messiah was informed by God that he should first ask for his eldest daughter's hand in marriage by name Muhammadi Begum. In this manner, his holy influence would enter directly into their family and their spiritual reformation would be brought about. God thus instructed the promised Messiah to tell Mirza Ahmad Beg, quote, to establish a relationship with you by giving his eldest daughter in marriage to you, and thus obtain light from your light. At this stage, we should pause and realize that the promised Messiah was married twice in his life. His first marriage to his cousin ended when he was 21 years old. For the next 28 years, he remained single before remarrying under God's instruction at age 49. This was a man who spent his young adulthood single. This was not a man who desired the marriage of Muhammadi Begum. In fact, he wrote that he would never contemplate such a union if God had not commanded it. The entire purpose of it was that their spiritual reformation should be brought about by their entry into the promised Messiah's household. This is the meaning that they should, quote, obtain light from your light. If Mirza Ahmad Beg didn't repent by marrying his eldest daughter, Muhammadi Begum, to the promised Messiah, then he himself would suffer misfortunes, according to the prophecy, culminating in his own death within 3 years of marrying his daughter to someone else. The prophecy also stated that her new husband would die, also within 3 years of the marriage. But Mirza Ahmad Beg was stubborn. He stubbed his nose at the prophecy and married his daughter to another man. 6 months later, he was dead. The house was plunged into grief. Two of the leading men of the family had died, as well as one of the nieces, only 25 years old. The family was humbled by such calamities and awestruck by the accuracy of the promised Messiah's prophecy. Ignoring the entire prophecy that I have laid out before you, Mr. Hijab misrepresents the prophecy as unfulfilled. He fails to mention the fulfillment of the prophecy, culminating in the death of three individuals of the family. Instead, he focuses only on a solitary statement of the promised Messiah, on whom be peace, and misunderstands that too. You see, on the death of Mirza Ahmad Beg, Mirza Sultan Muhammad, the name of the husband of Muhammadi Begum, newly wed, was utterly terrified. After all, he had been mentioned in the prophecy along with Mirza Ahmad Beg, who had already been slain by it. As a result, he wrote letters of remorse and contrition to the promised Messiah. Given their collective remorse, the promised Messiah released a statement, only part of which Muhammad Hijab quoted. Let's take a look at the statement Mr. Hijab objects to.
But the death of Ahmad Beg broke their backs, and this was why they sent letters of apology and regret. So he's acknowledging that they sent letters of apology and regret. As they were struck by fear and terror in their hearts, it was essential that God the Most High, according to his ancient way, postpone the date of punishment to some later time. That is, to the time when those people again turn back fully to another time of fearing and turning to God is displayed, and is proved by the whole of the Quran. But the essence of the prophecy that this woman will enter into this marriage with me is an absolute fate. Listen to this carefully. Is an absolute fate which cannot be averted. Now this is clear. So after these days, when God the Most High sees that these people's hearts have hardened and that they have not valued the few days of respite and relaxation given to them, then he will turn to the fulfillment of the prophecy of his holy word.
So what's this all about? In this passage, the promised Messiah states his belief that his marriage to Muhammadi Begum, the wife of Mirza Sultan Muhammad, is what is known as taqdeer-i-mubram, in other words, an unalterable decree of God. It is a prophecy that cannot be changed. On the one hand, the promised Messiah makes clear that the prophecy of punishment of the husband, Mirza Sultan Muhammad, is conditional on good behavior, and that if he repents and amends, the punishment will be put off. On the other hand, he states his conviction that the prophecy of his marriage to Muhammadi Begum is unalterable. He reconciles these two concepts in the last portion of the quote by stating his belief that Mirza Sultan Muhammad will return to bad behavior, and that when he does, not if, God will fulfill the prophecy of his death, and Muhammadi Begum will then be married to him. This was the promised Messiah's interpretation of what God had told him. Indeed, this is a sign of the truth of prophets of God. Though they receive messages from the unseen, they do not know how they will be fulfilled, and so they interpret the prophecies as best they can. In 1908, when informed of a person who had made a similar objection to that of Muhammad Hijab's, the promised Messiah stated, quote, if he has such doubts which are rising in his mind, that he might not even stay firm as a firm believer of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be on him. The incident of Hudaybiyah is present before us. What are his views about that? Then regarding Abu Jahl, it was shown that he had received a bunch of grapes from heaven. However, he never came to accept Islam. Prophet Jesus, peace be upon him, promised 12 of his companions 12 thrones, but one of them conspired against him, resulting in his arrest. Others sent curses upon him and left him in a time of dire need. Allah the Almighty promised the Prophet Moses, peace be upon him, that he will be the owner of a promised land, but many years passed and nothing happened. We must remember that the prophesied purpose of marrying Muhammadi Begum was so that, quote, they should obtain light from your light. The purpose of the marriage was to bring about the spiritual reformation of the whole family. If they spiritually reformed, however, by entering into the following of the promised Messiah, then physical marriage would no longer be necessary, as its purpose would be already fulfilled through a spiritual union of master and disciple. Indeed, in religious terminology, becoming a follower of a prophet is metaphorically referred to as marriage. Jesus, for example, referred to himself as the bridegroom and his followers as his brides. In the Song of Solomon, the Prophet Solomon, peace be on him, refers to himself as the bride in relation to the coming of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be on him, who is described as the bridegroom. Similarly, Jesus' parable of the king and his prince's wedding describes the advent of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be on him, as a wedding day. Ultimately, this is what happened, witnessing the extraordinary fulfillment of the prophecies, resulting in the death of three members of their family. They entered en masse into the following of the promised Messiah, thus becoming his spiritual brides. The following is a list of Muhammadi Begum's family members who recognized his truth. Muhammadi Begum's mother, her brothers and sisters, her cousins, her nephews, and her own two children all accepted the promised Messiah by entering his covenant. In this way, the prophecy of marriage was magnificently fulfilled, albeit not in the manner originally envisaged. From a common sense perspective too, this can be appreciated, since we should remember that Mirza Sultan Muhammad was married to Muhammadi Begum. For the promised Messiah to marry her, the husband would have to continue his misconduct and not repent, thus earning the prophesied death. Thus, the marriage was conditional on her husband's behaviour, but was mubram insofar that its purpose would always be fulfilled, which it was, since the whole family entered the following of the promised Messiah. In the end, I'll finish with the words of Muhammadi Begum's son himself, Mirza Ishaq Muhammad. He wrote, "In accordance with this prophecy, my maternal grandfather, Mirza Ahmed Beg, died, and the rest of the family was put in fear and became inclined towards reform, the irrefutable proof of which is that most of them joined the Ahmadiyya movement, in consequence of which God Almighty, being forgiving and merciful, changed his wrath into mercy." The people about whom the prophecy was made unequivocally acknowledged that the prophecy was fulfilled and accepted the promised Messiah, peace be on him. So who is Mr. Hijab to reject its fulfillment? In the end, I'd like to thank Mr. Hijab for providing us the opportunity to lay out before his non-Ahmadi Muslim followers the magnificence of this prophecy. Stay tuned as we go through other false objections he has raised about other extraordinary prophecies of the promised Messiah and Imam Mahdi, Mirza Ghulam Ahmad, on whom be peace. Thank you.